Thank you.
Bit of a confession. I'm about as sharp as a beach ball about now. I, as Jane said, I'm based in the UK. Of travelling down with my two-year-old who hasn't quite understood that we're in a different time zone. So for the last three nights between about 1 and 6 a.m., we've been playing with, So bear with me. I may get some words mixed up, but if you can fill in the gaps, that would work really well for all of us. Probably a company you've never heard about, but we are actually a New Zealand-based organisation, so head office is here, but primarily most of our business is offshore. I think about 95% of our revenue. Primarily we're operating in the bill payment space, so when bill is due and shortly thereafter, so we deal with a lot of missed payments. What Talking Tech does that's unique is we put a wrapper around both the communication, so the communication channels around SMS, voice, email, inbound, outbound, etc., with payment processing. So we'll send a message, tell a customer how much, give them the different options of making a payment. As it says up there, we've been doing this in 8 countries now, been around for about 30 years. But as of this month, we've actually been acquired by a company called Illion, formerly Dun & Bradstreet, which I'm sure a few in the room will know, sort of the large data and analytics company here in Australia, New Zealand region. So we're very excited about this opportunity that we've got here. Taking their data with our capability and the metadata that we actually get from the work we do with our clients, and have some really exciting products on the roadmap there. You don't need that. Introduction about my talk today. I'm going to be speaking a lot around the differences between operator preferences around bill payment versus consumer preferences and the absolute need to find a balance. I'm going to be talking about how direct debit is not a silver bullet. Again, I'm going to take quite a UK perspective on this from some of the data that we see, particularly in the mobile operator space, and about the importance to start prioritising payment channels that allow the customer to push payments to you. So not going back to the fact that you're not relying on direct debit as a silver bullet, addressing the customers that do not have the direct debit does not suit. So the economy is a lot of talk. Unemployment is down, which is great, and it came up today earlier from I think it was the MasterCard lady about the gig economy. So while unemployment is coming down, the number of people in what's been referred to as non-full-time work is increasing. Now, what this means is that you've got people with, traditionally, they would have had a very regular payment amount coming, had a very regular time that was happening. But with the likes of the Uber, Deliveroo, you're getting people who are now getting paid irregular amounts at irregular time intervals. And the likes of a direct debit just simply does not meet this type of customer, this cohort. Now, I couldn't find any New Zealand in Australia that they're putting it around about 4 million people within under freelancing, according to their tax returns. So it's significant number there that are involved in that. So direct debit. You'd be very familiar with it here in New Zealand, obviously. In the UK, what's interesting is that every mobile operator mandates that you must have a direct debit if you want an account. So this has been pulled off the Vodafone UK website. Didn't mean to pick on them, it's just the fact that theirs was pretty on the website. Most of them are buried in T's and C's. But if you want to have a mobile account, and again, if you're in the gig economy, you probably rely very heavily on your mobile, and you need to have a postpaid account as part of that job, they mandate that you must have a DD set up. And credit to Vodafone, they found benefits for them, not consumer, not Vodafone themselves, about taking away hassle. the payments are automatic, etc., and the direct debit guarantee. Now, the biggest benefit of DD absolutely is for the operator. Hands down, the lowest cost of collect. You're not having to chase people, give them reminders about it. You simply help yourself fit to the bank account. Wrong. I'm a massive user personally of direct debit, but I'm not the type of person that struggles necessarily with balancing my finances, which, as we saw on the previous slide, up to 4 million people have their irregular payments. So the challenge we've got is what are corporates are doing to address the customers that do not fit in. Because what we're seeing a lot is that you'll have the same bill payment strategy if they're on direct debit or if they're a non-DD customer. Now, even if you mandate 100% of your customers must be on DD, within about 6 months, that drops to about between 90 and 93%. Now, in the UK, where some of our clients that we're dealing with, and I'll be sharing some of the case study details for O2, you've got 8 million customers. That's about 600,000 customers a month that you're needing to find another way for them to make a payment. And if you don't address these customers, the cost to serve skyrockets. So they'll end up in your call center, they fall into just sending letters, etc. So you absolutely need to address. I do feel for corporates though, because the average customer isn't necessarily paying that much attention to their water bill or their mobile bill. This is the research that came in from Microsoft, and we're getting dangerously close to the same average attention span as a goldfish. So again, this fits very, very well with what's come out from Zealand about the need that consumers, and you'll know this yourselves, you absolutely prioritise the frictionless payments that you have. So if something's a little bit too hard, or you've got to speak to someone, or the hours, you push, and it doesn't take much to lose the attention of someone. So while you've absolutely got attention, you need to make it a frictionless payments journey as possible. But yeah, based on this calculation, I think we've got about another year or so to go. The study was a few years back till we were about level goldfish. Not good. The challenge we've got, though, is that a lot of corporates out there go, right, we need to build an e-commerce or an online payment journey. And the first thing they do is they put up username and password. Now, absolutely critical, and we've heard a lot about it today, and we absolutely need to, as an industry, solve this. But if all you're asking that person to do is pay your bill, so they're not going to get access to any information, they can't pay anyone else, it is simply to pay what is owing, we argue there's no need to put it behind a username and password. Now, example, an energy company over there, and they had only 2% of customers actually who started their payments journey made it through to make a payment. So it's 98% of people who started off, but after the eighth different pay, instead of using special characters, they actually give up. Then when they ask for a journey, there's eight or nine different things can do it, go in there, and then while that consumer may have intended to purposely go in there to pay a bill, they go and change an address or find out what they've got left in their package. So we argue by knowing your customer, by being proactive with them, you can actually take away a lot of that friction involved in the password. So I'd like to use O2 Telefonica as a bit of an example. That. So Telefonica very early on addressed that they needed to remove friction within its bill payment. So they had all the tools. So mandated direct debit, they had online payment journey, you could go down to the post office, make a payment, it was all there. But they still had a significant number of customers falling into collections every month. So we've been working with them about friction with bill payment journey and identifying the non-DD specifically. So as you'll see here, text message goes out, it's a file that comes in daily, variable information within the text, such as the name, the amount owing, and importantly, the URL that you see up there. So that is a unique personalized URL that Joe belongs in this case. Now, Joe can either click that link or call that number. For O2, they don't really care which path it goes down. If they call the number that's on there, they can't speak to an agent, and all that they can do is pay the bill, or they click the link. Now, because we know it's Joe Bloggs through that unique URL, only Joe got that URL, we can remove the need for any passwords. So we're not sitting there passively trying to defend people trying to come in separately. We've proactively gone out to the consumer, given them the link or the path in, and then so we can present to them just only what they need to make that payment. So we don't display any personal information on this in case someone does randomly get a link to someone else's bill, but all they can do is enter in their credit or debit card number, they can take a photo of their card, use the secure element on the phone to pre-populate that, and then hit make a payment. So one page for them to pay their bill. At the end, they get a receipt that pops up, and also very important, we send them an SMS to stop the consumer picking up the phone and calling the call center to say I've made a payment, which is one of the most expensive phone calls you can get and most pointless. But part of this journey now as well, once we've recognized that customer, we can actually give the option of tokenizing their preferred card number. And again, it's irrespective if they've come in via the inbound number or if they've clicked the link and made a payment, we can give the customer, and again, as the client, we can choose if they want an opt-in or opt-out process around tokenization. But once we've got that customer, we've linked them proxy usually to their mobile that we'll use, next time they come into collections or next time their bill is due, we can slightly change the message up. Now, so where previously we had click this link or call this number, we now have the option saying click this link or if you wish to pay with your registered card ending in 0549, reply yes. Customer hits yes and the payment is processed. So this is removing all friction as far as we're concerned, as much as you can, still putting the customer in control of the payment. So you're not pulling the funds, you're still putting the consumer at the heart of choosing when to pay and how to pay. So if they choose to use their or they can click a link to pay with another card. The results we are getting on that are absolutely fantastic. Now this is before the bill is due, once the bill is processed, we'll send out an SMS. Who are not on direct debit, and we've seen an uplifted 29% in payments during that period compared to the graphic on the left, which just pointed them to their main payment site. So a 29% uplift by removing friction within it, and again, I think I keep thinking around this attention span that we've got to try and get the customer when they're ready, when they want to make the payment, and try and get it done within 10 seconds, and why we've seen that sort of uplift here. Now, where this works brilliantly as well is when we're into the customers who are in financial difficulty. So rather than saying that you need to pay the full balance, so once we've got that card tokenized, we can, and they choose not to pay, they're now into overdue, we can give the consumer the option to make smaller part payments. So whether they pay 10% or $10 towards their bill and make regular payments towards that to get the balance down, we can have different strategies depending on where in the bill cycle that customer has. But once we've got that tokenized card, we can open up those options. So some of the stats, and this is all case study, which is why I can share it, but we're now getting up to 43% of O2's customers entering collections has a registered card. We think around 48% is probably about the highest we can get. You obviously get fraud that come in, so customers that have no intention of paying and never going to register a card, and the ones that just don't trust the system, which is fine. O2 a 7% cost saving into additional account, which is great. But the stat up there now is that 23% of customers now pay by SMS, which is a fantastic stat and fits really well with what's come out of Payments New Zealand, where consumers want text-based payments. They feel it's sophisticated, they feel it's safe, etc. And what was interesting with O2 is we actually started the early stage collections piece, and what we found is that consumers were waiting to fall into collections, which is why we had to bring it into the bill due place. The other stat that came out of it is around that the customer with a registered card is 5 times more likely to pay than a non-registered card. So once a customer registered, once they've got belief in the system, there's them staying with you. The is around the 4% of more customers removed in 3 days. Makes a significant impact into cash flow, particularly when I think someone like themselves would have £25 million of outstanding bills every month. It's a significant impact to cash flow. So in summary, by tokenizing the card, by tokenizing the customer's preferred payment method, you can remove a lot of friction around that bill payment journey. You don't need to ask for passwords. You don't need to verify who you're speaking to. By being proactive, you know who they are and making that journey frictionless. Once you've also tokenized, you can give customers options depending on where they are in the dunning process around if they want to pay full balance or can pay full balance versus pushing smaller, I'll use the example, $10 a week till they make that payment off. And the key takeaway for me to give to you guys is about if you have SMS notifications within your journey now, look to turn that notification into a payment channel. Make it easy for customers. Stop pointing them to other areas and let them work with you within their preferred channel. That's it from me.